Hi everyone. This talk is about taking language-oriented modularity from theory to practice. I'm Arik Hadass, and this work was done at the Open University of Israel as a joint work with David Doran. Language-oriented modularity, LOM, is a methodology that takes domain-specific aspect languages, DSALs, and puts them at the center of the software modularization process. It changes the way we develop software. Traditionally, we used to adapt the concerns that we need to handle to the programming languages that are available for us. In LOM, it is done vice versa. We adapt the programming languages to our concerns. For each concern, we define a language that is most suitable for it. And then we can start implementing the language and at the same time to solve the concern using the language. This middle-up process is similar to that of language-oriented programming, LOP, but in LOM it is applied with DSALs. Those are languages that are both domain-specific and aspect-oriented. Not only do they provide abstractions and notations from the problem domain, but they also provide an additional modularization mechanism. In principle, LOM is similar to LOP. In both, we use a middle-out process, and we end up having a software that is written in many different languages. The only difference is that in LOM, these languages are aspect-oriented. But this difference has high impact on the practicality of LOM. LOM is more costly than LOP because DSALs are harder to implement. And LOM is less effective than LOP because the benefit one would get by using a DSAL rather than a general purpose aspect language is lower than the obvious benefit one would get by using DSL rather than general. This work improves the cost effectiveness of LOM and by that makes it practical for real-world software development. Why is it important to make LOM practical? So, the first argument would be that DSALs are useful. They allow us to achieve improved modularity by separating out cross-cutting concerns that, as we shall see later on, can still be found in modern software development. And unlike GPALs that provide this ability at the expense of the complexity of the programming language that we use, DSALs generally enrich existing languages with modularity constructs. DSALs actually simplify the language by providing simpler and more declarative syntax and abstract those modularity constructs. The second argument would be that DSALs often need to be implemented on demand for our application. DSALs tend to be tightly coupled with the applications they were developed for, and as a result, they are less usable in different applications. Let me demonstrate the discussion. Here is a typical use of a DSL. In that case, it is the application that depends on the DSL. Note that nothing in this SQL statement contains data that is specific to a particular application. It is the application that decides when to use the DSL and to provide it all the data that it needs. Therefore, it can be relatively easy to use the same DSL in a different application. In contrast, here is code written in a DSAL we implemented for new commander that I will describe later on. It specifies the logs that should be produced for each operation. And let's focus on the second line. Case start, in case the operation starts, we should produce a log message called copy started with certain values. And here is the method in the application that starts an the execution of an operation. It is called start and recites in the first class. When we examine the interaction between the DSAL and the base code, we see that this time it is the DSAL code that depends on the application. The case start part would be translated to after execution of the start method, and the values we specify refers to properties in the operating class. This kind of dependency with both the structure and the data representation in the application makes DSL much more difficult to use in different applications. Therefore, we need to create DSLs on demand for our application, and this is exactly what LOM is designed for. In a sense, LOM is even more important for DSLs than LOP is for DSLs. But the main problem is the cost effectiveness of LOM. Let me explain why. So the root cause is that DSLs seem to be second class. They are second class DSLs, and therefore they are more costly to implement than ordinary, non-aspect oriented DSLs. And they are second class aspect languages. Therefore they are less effective to program with than ordinary DSLs. By saying that DSLs are second class DSLs, we mean that language workbenches that greatly simplify the implementation of DSLs do not fit for DSLs. The reason for that is that when using a language workbench, we transform a language to a domain-specific language to an existing language. And this type of transformations generally don't work for DSLs because of multi-DSL conflicts that I will describe next. And without such transformation, the implementation of the weaving semantics is generally a costly task. The conflict that I mentioned can be classified as two types. The first type refers to foreign advising conflicts. Foreign advising is a case where an aspect written in one DSL advises a join point that resides in an aspect written in a different DSL. A conflict may happen when the advice is not supposed to be exposed. The second type refers to co-advising conflicts. Co-advising is when two aspects written in different DSLs advise the same join point at the base point. A conflict may happen when they are applied in a different order. And by saying that DSLs are second-class aspect languages, we refer to the lack of development tools for the DSLs. The lack of common editing tools such as text highlighting and auto-completion makes it harder to edit DSL code. The lack of aspect development tools such as HADT makes it harder to browse and navigate DSLs. And the lack of build tools makes them harder to compile. This lack of tools hinders the effectiveness of programming with these languages despite their simpler and more declarative syntax. So to achieve first-class DSLs, we need the following capabilities. We need the ability to produce composable DSLs, we need an efficient process for that, and we need front-end development tools. What are our options today? We can use composition frameworks, but they are focused on the weaving semantics. They only allow us to produce composable DSLs, but they don't provide an efficient process for that, nor they produce the development tools that we wish for. Using a language workbench and transforming a DSL to a GPL is not really an option because of the multi-DSL conflicts. And using a language workbench together with the composition framework is possible, but the process will remain complicated and we won't be provided with all the tools that we need. So this work presents an approach to get all these capabilities for practical LOM. How do we do this? So the key idea of our approach is to transform DSLs into a GPL that is annotated with metadata. With that, we can replace the complicated process of DSL implementation using composition framework with a much simpler process that is similar to that of DSL. And it also allows us to easily achieve compatibility of DSLs that are intended for the GPL with DSL code. The metadata that we need is of two types. The first type addresses multi-DSL conflicts. So first, it allows us to specify during the transformation which join points should be hidden from other aspects. That's for preventing conflicts of foreign environment. Second, it allows us to specify during the transformation ordering values for the advice to prevent conflicts of type call value. With that, we achieve first class equality with DSLs. The process of implementing the DSL becomes similar to that of DSL. We don't need to modify any compiler or interoperability driver. And we actually can leverage the existing tools for DSLs, which are language workbenches. The second type of metadata is for achieving compatibility with GPL tools. So first, it allows us to store the source code location of advice as it was in the original DSL code. Second, it allows us to produce standalone transformations that the compiler can invoke internally. With that, we achieve first-class equality with aspect languages. By preserving the location of advice, we can leverage the aspect development tools for the GPL and get the browsing and navigation capabilities. By enabling the compiler to receive DSL code as an input, we can reuse compilation build tools of the GPL for a project that uses DSL code. And by implementing the DSLs using the language workbench, we can produce an IDE for a plugin for an IDE that provides the common editing tools. We implemented our approach by defining a small set of metadata for AspectJ that I will describe next. We modified the AspectJ compiler to support our metadata. Note that this is just a one-time effort rather than per DSL, and the changes were designed to be minimal and optional, so we could easily reapply them on newer version of the compiler. And we slightly modified AJDT to support our metadata. So what is the metadata? It includes ID notation per type, method, and field that allows us to specify for each of them the join points that should be hidden from other aspects and associated with the particular problem. It also includes the order annotation that that contains an ordering value of advice, and the bridge source location that can store the original location of advice in the DSL code. With that advice, AJDT is able to work properly with DSL code. And finally, the transformation interface. It allows the compiler to identify which source code files should be translated using the extension method, and to transform them using the second method. We evaluated our approach by two case studies of where we applied LOM on two open source projects and comparing the implementation effort of POOL. We applied LOM to implement a new cross-cutting feature of auditing called MU Audit. And using this language, we audited two file operations that are supported in MU Commander. Here is a screenshot of MU Commander. It is a lightweight cross-platform file manager with UL pane interface, and the file operations there were not audited. So we defined the language in Xtext just like an ordinary DSL. Then we used the language to write the code that we saw earlier to audit the operation. Note that we were provided with the common editing tools, and surprisingly, we were also provided with AJDT marker markers not only on the base code, but also at the DSAF code. Then we implemented our language by defining a transformation of the DSAL code into GPL that includes our metadata. The lessons we learned from this case study were that we successfully implemented the DSAL using the Xtext language workbench, again similar to that of DSL. The programming experience of with this language was similar to that of a GPL in terms of the tool support. And as a result, we conclude that in this case, the LLM process was cost effective compared to the LLP process. In the second case study, we applied LLM to implement three DSLs for cross-cutting concerns in Ovid, namely synchronization, permission checks, and auditing. So Ovid is a large-scale and distributed platform for data center virtualization management. The operations that are supported in Ovid are called commands. We found that the cross-cutting concerns I mentioned were scattered across most of the command classes. We also found that they were tangled in the root class of all the operations. So using our DSALs, we implemented aspect solutions. Here is, for example, the solution for the synchronization. And the lessons from this case study were that we successfully separated out the cross-cutting concerns. The code that was scattered across the command classes was extracted and encapsulated in modules written in the DSAL. The code that was tangled in the root class was also extracted. It also provided another evidence for the practicality of our approach. The implementation of each DSAL was a matter of just few hours. And it was another evidence for the effectiveness of using the languages even in a large-scale and complex project like Ovid. And last but not least, we implemented COOL, a DSAL for thread synchronization, and we used this language to synchronize the bounded stack. Then we compared the implementation effort of our implementation and the implementation in the awesome composition framework. So here is the code of the coordinator in COOL that synchronizes a bounded stack. When we added an aspect J aspect that uses the bounded stack, we saw that without our metadata, without our hide annotations, multi-DSAL conflicts reproduced. When we added the metadata, they were prevented. So we concluded the metadata was able to prevent such multi-DSAL conflicts. If you want to compare the implementation effort in our approach and in the OSO composition framework, then you will see that in our approach, much less code was required. The language designer needed to know higher level programming language in the form of AspectJ instead of low level bytecode manipulation tools. And we implemented COOL in the Spoofox language workbench, and that is an evidence that our approach is agnostic to the selection of the language workbench. This work focuses on domain-specific aspect languages. It presents a transformation-based approach for the implementation that can address multi-DSAL conflicts, but doing that, all of that inside the language workbench, just like DSL. In conclusion, we showed that LLM can be similar to LLP. We showed that for a subgroup of DSALs, those that can be translated to existing GPL, but we also showed that this grouping is interesting because it can solve real-world problems. those DSLs become cost effective. We reduce their implementation cost and increase their effectiveness, and by that LOM becomes practical. All the code that is related to the implementation and the evaluation is available on our GitHub page. Yes, thank you.
So we have time for some questions. Any questions from the audience?
Okay, the definition of lightweight DSLs and how they interact or something is basically a solved problem in Lisp languages, and there's no hassle at all. So the question is, how does your approach compare to those semantic transformations? Can you compare those? What are the advantages and disadvantages?
So compare with what?
With how Lisp-like languages handle the creation of DSLs.
Unfortunately, I'm not aware of how it is done in Lisp. So I can't refer to that.
Okay, then you might have a look at it because it's really concise and simple.
It could be interesting for related work.
Yeah,
definitely.
Yeah,
I'm
just
I have another one. So, you in the evaluation, you have this notion of being cost effective, right? And I was wondering, is that based on metrics? Does it make sense to extend that to a user study at some point? Or you probably have some thought about that. And if you can repeat my question from the recording, that would be great.
Yeah, so the question was, how do we measure cost effectiveness? Is there a need for a case study? So it was a topic that we invested much time into to think about how we can evaluate it properly. And yes, case study is one option. We took another approach. We if we show that we use the same process and the same tools, then we can show that the effectiveness is about the same. Okay? So by using language workbenches that are commonly used for DSLs, and by not having to do any additional task like compiler modifications that we need, which really is the difference between the implementation of DSLs and DSL, we concluded the process are similar and the effort is comparable. So we use the term the baseline of LOP to push to that baseline.
Yeah, so on the one hand, you said that once you develop such a language, in principle, it should be reusable. And later on, you tie development directly into a particular application. Couldn't you put a little more effort into making your languages parametric in some way so that you increase the possibility of reusing them in different applications?
So the question is about the reusability of the produced DSLs,
yes.
If we can make them more reusable. Actually, I will say we want to take the different direction. We say that if the implementation cost is that low, just a matter of few hours, there's no reason to make them reusable. By trying to design them for being reusable for other applications, they will be more complicated. So it's like a cycle, you know. If the language that you need is easy to implement and to use, keep it that way. Don't try to make it to parameterize it or something like this. Because again, if it's no time to in a perspective of a software project to implement those languages, then what's the point? And the coupling that I show is, you know, give a sense of the difficulty to make them usable. Of course, not for all of them, but many.
Thanks. Thanks to the speaker again.